Full start. I forgot to record the audio. So great if you're lip reading, otherwise not so great. So let's start again. This is our October 2021 performance figures for our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 here in the UK, along with our Tesla Model 3, Hyundai Kona electric usage, plus other things that have happened during the month. So stay tuned. Hi, John here, and welcome. If you tune in regularly, you'll know that I like to give an update on what's been happening during the month before we get into the stats and figures. I have an update on the Kona electric. On Monday, the 25th of October, I received a call from Cal, who's the case manager for the recall for the battery packs for the Hyundai company. She apologized for the delay in responding to my letters. She said that she can initiate a buyback, which is what I requested them to do. She said the price, the buyback price would be the cap price, and she needed a few days to find out what that would be and would call me back on Thursday. During the call, she did explain that the cap price was the sort of dealer price, although I've since learned that cap stands for car auction price. More on that in a minute. She asked me how much I paid for the car. This information was included in the letter that I wrote to them, along with a copy of my invoice. So obviously no research or preparation before the phone call. She also offered me an option of moving my case up the waiting list if I decided I wanted to keep the car. And I said I'd make that decision once she came back to me with the buyback price. The initial time frame for replacing the battery pack was between October 2021 and 2022, so it could be a whole year before we get our battery replaced. She's saying by moving you up the queue, it would get done before Christmas. Put the phone down and thought, well, wait till Thursday. Thursday arrived, no call from Hyundai. Friday passed, no phone call. I'm recording this on Monday, 1st of November, still no phone call. Is fairly typical of Hyundai's customer care. In the meantime, I went on to We Buy Any Car website and got a price of £27,625. I paid £33,360 back in November 2018, which works out at a loss of about, well, not about, exactly £5,735 over almost 3 years. Although we didn't actually get the car delivered until the 1st of July 2019, so over 2.5 years, if you like. So a loss of around £1,900 per year and 13,000 miles of motoring, which actually isn't too bad for a brand new car off the parking lot. I guess I'm now at a point where I will be getting rid of the car, either back to Hyundai, depending on the price they give me, or selling to someone like WeBuyAnyCar.com. I don't want to be part of the Hyundai brand anymore. I moved from Toyota because they didn't offer battery electric vehicles and continued to push their rather outdated hybrid technology. Hyundai looked great and the product is good. It's just they're let down by really poor customer service, attention to detail, lack of knowledge. Almost every interaction with them, be it at dealership level or direct with Hyundai, has been a battle to get any information and the truth. So what are we doing? Well, we've decided to get a second smaller range battery electric vehicle. We currently have two 300 mile plus range EVs sitting on the driveway. And we probably only, in fairness, need one with that range, which means we're looking for a second car between 100, 200 mile range, something like that, the maximum. And we'll get that once the Kona's been sorted and sold. Let's talk about heating. I've been using the two far infrared panels, which I've installed. We've got one 1800 watt one, which is ceiling hung in my photography studio. This has been on twice during the month of October when I've been working in there. The heat from there is brilliant. It is just like standing in the sunshine. You stand under the unit and you can feel the heat soaking into your body. You move away from the unit and it's like, I don't know, like a cloud's gone over the sun. although if you leave the heater on for long enough, it does heat up the fabric of the room. However, if you're using it for short burst durations like I've been using, then it does need to be positioned where people are actually stationed to get the best from it. E.g., if it's on the other side of the room, then you're not really going to feel the benefit from it unless it's left on to heat the whole fabric of that room over a longer period of time. The other infrared panel is mounted in the ceiling in the double garage. This is directly above one of the cars. As infrared heats objects rather than the air, like a conventional heater, like wet radiators or hot air blowers or things like that, I thought positioning it directly above the car's bonnet would keep the car warm and prevent condensation forming during those colder, damper months. I'll keep you posted on that. The garage panel is a 720 watt panel, and I do have two of them, but to date I've only installed all the one of them. I will be installing the second panel. I've also purchased some more Akasa smart plugs, so I can trigger the heaters on and off and set time schedules to be on and off as well, so that's quite handy. Yeah, I'm really happy with the infrared panels. They use much less electricity than what I had previously. I used a portable oil heater, which was an oil-filled radiator thing on wheels that you could move about, and that was rated at 2000 watts. And that really needed to be on full power for a long time to get the room to a sensible temperature in my photography studio. And that was sort of about 20, 21 degrees Celsius. What else? Oh yes, the twice yearly event of the clocks changing catches some products out as if it's been, like a surprise event that they can't plan for. This time it was the myenergi products and the Tesla app that all fell foul of this. The myenergi devices jumped back an hour a week too early, despite me having them set of get time and date from the cloud. Our Zappi and Eddi both lost an hour, and thankfully to myenergi, they were really quick off the mark and provided an over-the-air firmware update very, very speedily, so full marks there. The downside to this update is that the myenergi app has lost the ability to stop the Zappi charging, a function that used to be there before the update. On the eddi, we're on version 3.051, and the Zappi is now on version 0.000, according to the app. So that's obviously where the problem is. It's great that myenergi are so responsive and engage with their customers. Here is a post from the myenergi forums updating us on the issue. And just note the time of the post. It's 8 a.m. on a Sunday. So, top marks to myenergi. Really go and talk to Hyundai about what good customer service looks like. The Tesla app also had a similar anomaly with a scheduled charging feature for the car. So if you wanted to edit the off-peak times, you had to choose 0530 if you wanted 4:30 a.m. I'm sure that'll sort it out over the next day or two. Actually, I haven't checked since, so I'll check that out. See if that's fixed itself. I'm sure it will have done. So yeah, when smart things are not so smart. So let's move on, shall we, to our month stats. I'll bring up the graphic as normal, which you can pause the video if you want to review. Alternatively, again, all the bits and bobs are down in the description down below, along with the components and their specifications. So our generation numbers for October 2021 are south-southwest facing 6.34 kilowatt arrays, produced a total of 437 kilowatt hours from the two arrays. I'm going to stop saying kilowatt hours and kilowatts, so I'll just give you the units. As expected, a drop against September's total. However, as you will see when we look at the sort of year-on-year for previous Octobers, it wasn't all bad news. Our average daily solar generation was 14.1 for the month. That gives us our sort of total generation figure for the period divided by the size of our solar array at 68 loads of numbers and letters after it. I'll bring it up on screen. So how did you all get on? Drop your comments and details and totals down below as normal. Thanks very much. Let's have a look at the two arrays. Our 4 kilowatt array produced 281, and our newer 2.34 array produced 156. And as you can see, they're well above the October 2020 totals when we had a sort of like for like setup. October 2019, we only had the one array at that time. This chart looks at our overall self-power for the month. We have been in cost-saving mode with the Powerwall. I haven't swapped it basically during the month as I did in September, bouncing in and out. And all through the month, the solar and Powerwall contributions accounted for 55% self-power for the month, which actually isn't too bad, I think. So yeah, quite happy with that. This is the year-on-year chart and compares October from 2011 through to 2021, a full 11 years of data. The values from 2020 onwards are for both arrays, whereas before that they were just for the 4 kilowatt array. So the 437, well ahead of our 2020 totals for the same setup by some country mile. This is the Powerwall in and out and its round trip efficiency. I'm still not 100% convinced this is spot on in terms of the money, so to speak. An 83% round trip efficiency just seems a little low based on previous months. It could be right, and the Powerwall is now starting to heat the battery pack, ready to accept the solar input in the morning, because the outside temperature is getting a little bit cooler and starting to drop. And remember, our Powerwall is situated outside and in a rather windy side of the house, so it could just be that, and that percentage is correct. So, I'll keep my eye on that and see how that manifests itself over the coming months. This chart is our day by day, which gives you a little bit more detail on the day by day during the month. House usage is shown in blue. The peaks there are when we charge one of the EVs. So we did quite a bit of charging this month, because we certainly use the Tesla a lot more this month, as you'll see when we get on to that. We also ran one of our glass kilns every day during the off-peak period, which adds about 6 kilowatts minimum to the daily total for the house usage. And even sometimes when the sun was out, we would also run the kiln during the day and get that free firing, which is actually what we're doing today, 1st November. It's really nice and sunny outside. So we've got one of the kilns on at the moment, and it's being powered by solar. We had in October, we had two great solar days where we generated 30 kilowatt hours during the day, and that was on the 6th and the 21st. And many of the days were a sort of really solid 15 to 20 generated, which, you know, really helped build up that good monthly total. We also managed to keep our export to the grid low this month, which is good to see, and with the highest daily export of 4.8. Which was on the 20th. We did have a few days of high grid pull, shown in red, which, as I said, were when we charged the cars. This is the chart which shows the four data sources we've just looked at in the day by day. House usage shown in blue. So it's a biggie this month, 1112.9 versus our solar total of 437. The house use a lot more energy, and as a result, use a lot more grid energy, which we'll see in a minute, coming onto that chart. So this is our average daily house usage and our average daily grid usage over the month. Not surprising, the average daily house usage was up to 35.9, so that's the blue line. And our average daily pull from the grid was also up at 23.4, that's the red line. It is a massive jump from September if you're looking at the September figures, but if you recall, if you watched last month's solar update, we were all away on holiday for 2 weeks during that month, so effectively it's only just 2 weeks of data rather than the 4 weeks of data. This chart looks at what we sent back to the grid. So we sent 28 kilowatts of excess solar back to the grid. Again, last month, if you're looking at September, was high because we were on holiday, so we're unable to soak up the electrons. But yeah, nice to see a nice low figure for October, especially as we had such a good generation total from our solar panels. This is what we pulled from the grid. So we consumed 726, which is down from previous October's actually. October 2020 would have been a like-for-like setup in terms of usage. So, you know, that's good to see. Although we've used a lot, we've actually used less than we did last year. This is the eddi, which heats our hot water from surplus solar. I was actually surprised to see that despite being really sunny, the eddi only diverted 15 of solar generation to heat our hot water during the month. And I think the main reason for that is that I've scheduled a boost set each morning for an hour, which tends to last all day once the water's hot. That's probably why we're not getting so much boosting from the solar. Running totals for the eddi are 342 for the year and 809 since installation. So look at the cars. We had a big month on the Tesla. The Tesla Model 3 covered 920 miles during the month, bringing its total mileage to 15,532. No issues or problems to report. We did two supercharging sessions where we added a total of 61.98, again all for no cost. Home charging added 280.41. Unfortunately, only 8% of our total charge for the month came from sunshine, with 257.97 coming from the grid. All this grid charging would have been at off-peak using the Octopus Energy Go Faster tariff at 5.5 pence. What else with the Tesla? Oh yeah, I had two over-the-air software updates during the month. We now have the ability to adjust the charging amps going into the car from the app, which actually is really, really useful. Previously, you had to go and do that from the car itself. We're now on software version 2021.36.5.5, which was downloaded and installed on the 27th of October. The Kona covered just 295 miles in the month and now has a total mileage of 13,309 miles. No software updates over the air this month, or any other month for that matter, since ownership. No issues or problems to report with the car either. That's it. So any questions, then drop them down into the comments below and I'll pick them up. As ever, please comment, like, share. All of those good actions help to get this video shown to more people on YouTube, which in turn helps my channel grow. Thank you for watching and I'll see you on the next video. All right, take care. Bye.